Welcome back to the second episode of Smart Contract Series. This time, we're going to actually look at how smart contracts work and how you can deploy your very own coin. I think we're gonna look at ERC20 tokens, we're gonna launch our own NFT, and also look at a simple contract. But there is something really exciting. If you stick around all the way through the end of the video, there's also a really cool giveaway thanks to our sponsors at Halborn who wanted to give this to us. So stick around, we'll look into it, and we'll come back and talk about the giveaway. All right, we are back for the second episode. I think this time we are going to actually deploy a contract. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
And you're going to show us how to do everything from finish to start, or start to finish, not finish to start, start to finish. And there might be some sort of a prize at the end, but you're going to tell us how to get it.
Yeah.
Cool.
At the end, we will talk about that. First of all, I will show you how to deploy a contract. We will go through as well how to deploy an ERC20 token. And then an NFT token. And finally, I have a surprise for everyone on here.
Okay. So last time we talked about, I think it was Brownie, Truffle, the tools that we're using. Are you using those tools?
Yeah. First of all, we will start with an online IDE called Remix, which is very easy to interact with and to work on that. And later on, we will deploy a test contract as well using Brownie on the common line.
You're using Solidity. I practiced today, so I can say it this time and no tongue twisters. Is that what we're using for this video?
Yes. We are going to use Solidity for the entire video.
Cool. Do you want to share your screen and we can jump into it?
Sure. Let's go. So first of all, let me introduce you. This is Remix. This is like an online IDE for Ethereum and all the EVM-based chains. And for this one, I'm going to start writing on a simple contract. To start writing a contract in Solidity, you first need to provide the version that you, the compiler that you are going to use using the syntax. Okay. And after that, you basically create a contract, you name the contract, and then here we go. Now we have an entire contract. This contract has no functionality at all. If we deploy this on chain, it has nothing, so we cannot interact with it. It will be just simply bytecodes stored on chain. So let's add some functionality to it. First of all, I'm going to create a variable. Okay, in Solidity, all variables are stored in 256 bits. And for this one, I'm going to name it using a public var, call it value. And then I'm going to create a function named test that has two parameters. Okay, let's call them A and let's call them B. And this function, we want to be it public, so it wants to be external, so everyone can call it, okay? And we are going to add some functionality to it. Basically, what we want is to store under value the sum of A plus B, okay? That's it. Now we have like a simple contract. On Remix, we can use this compile feature to compile the contract, and once we have compiled it, we can go here to run and execute the contract. Here we have different accounts that are created on a VM for Ethereum that is stored in the browser itself. It's not using any testnet or using the mainnet. It's just an instance on the browser. And we are going to deploy the test contract. We can click here, and then we have the contract deployed. Okay. Now, if we go here, we can start interacting with it. If we check the value for this contract, we see that right now is zero. And if we try to call the test function, we can give it two parameters, let's say one and two, let's call it. And here we have, if we now check the value, you see that it's three, okay? So this is like a really cool way of deploying contracts, creating your contracts and so on. But sometimes it's complex if you are trying to manage like thousands or hundreds of Solidity files. For that, we have better options. We will go through them on later on. But this is really cool to start working on and to see the contracts. You even have a debugger. You can see all the transactions, and it's really convenient for everyone to want to start. Okay.
Is this actually being deployed now, or is this just, so? This is not no long. We're not no long. So yesterday you showed us what was the website called that we used yesterday?
EtherScan.
Yes, that was more of a interactive learning experience. It was for you to, you know, try things, but this is actually you're creating a contract and it's going to be live in a bit.
This is only on the browser storage right now.
Okay.
Right now I will show you how to deploy this same contract on chain. Okay. If you want, or probably we can we can do it live as well. How to deploy that on chain.
Okay.
See it. Okay. Okay, so let's go and do that. So right now what we will going to do is deploy that exact same contract, but this time on a testnet chain. Okay. This was running on the browser. Right now we will be using MetaMask. So MetaMask is a wallet management utility that allows you to create your own wallets, to fund them, to transfer funds, and basically to interact with all EVM-based chains. Okay. Mm-hmm. For this one, I'm going to use a demo account I just made. And we are going to deploy this contract on the Rinkaby testnet network. Okay. So let's go and do that. As you can see, once I click deploy, pop-up opens, and I have to confirm. And this transaction will actually go on-chain. We can see on Etherscan, the pending transaction here. And once this transaction gets mined on-chain, the contract will be deployed. If we go back to Remix and wait just some seconds, we will see soon the contract popping up here. And we can interact again, call the test function, and check the value. But every time that we want to interact with the chain, the MetaMask pop-up will show. Okay, here we have the contract. We can see the value. This is actually value stored on chain. Okay, and if we go back to Rinkaby, we can see that the contract was already deployed. We can go and see the contract, and this was the contract deployment.
Nice. Okay. So you earlier also in the intro mentioned about creating an ERC-20 token. Can you also show us that and tell us why someone would want to make their own token?
Yeah. Sure. So here I have like a sample token. Basically, on Ethereum, everyone can create their own token. Basically, token is just a smart contract deployed on-chain, which is holding the balances for all the accounts that are interacting with it. And to make the life simpler, OpenZeppelin has already made some contracts. Okay, OpenZeppelin is just a library for smart contracts on Solidity based. And here we have already some contracts which we can import and use, okay? And for this one, I'm going just to create my token. Let's call it my token. And it will have a pre-mint token of over like 100,000 tokens, okay? So I'm going to deploy this one locally. I will not be using MetaMask, because otherwise I have to wait too long. And for this one, let's just store it and deploy my token contract. Once we have the token deployed, we can see the name of the token. In this case, it's like my token. We can even see the symbol, so like my token as well, and also the total supply for this token. So you can see here that number is like huge. Okay, on Ethereum we don't store everything like integers. We keep as well some floating numbers to store decimals. And for example, I'm going to use this account, the second account here. And I'm going to transfer from the first account to the second account some funds, okay? To this account, I'm going to transfer, let's say, 5,000 transact. And now, if we check the total supply will not change. But if I check the balance of this account, we can see that it's 5,000, okay? So this is like a simple token. You can deploy that on chain as well and test it if you want. And this is like a minimal token. If you go to the OpenZeppelin contract wizard page, you can create your own token with different functionalities. You can create a token that is mintable, that is burnable, and that has a lot of other stuff. Okay, it's a really convenient utility to create your own token easily.
Okay, so let's say I made my own token. How do I create or allow people to mint their own NFTs using this token? Is that possible? Okay.
That's something apart. So basically, right now, what we have is a token. And then if you want to create an NFT, you have to deploy another contract. Okay. So okay. I can show you how to deploy an NFT. But of course, you can create your own logic that allows to buy NFTs using your own token. You can do that, of course. But yeah, that's something I will show you on this demo. But let's go and, for example, deploy a sample NFT.
Okay.
So this is a little bit more complex. I don't want to go through all the code and what it has, but basically we will do the same steps. We will deploy this contract on the local instance on this browser. And let's save that and deploy the my token. And let's do that. So now what we have here is an NFT contract. Okay, an NFT contract, we have the same name as before. And this one has the save main functionality. So basically, once the user wants to buy an NFT, we go here, we click the save mint, and then the user has an NFT. As you will see, it's just a mapping between users and IDs. It's nothing else. So let's, for example, mint an NFT for myself using that account. So let's mint one. Let's, why not mint one more? And if we go now to the owner of the token zero, which is the first one that is minted on the on this contract, we can see here that this is myself. And if we check the ID one as well, this is myself. Okay. The cool thing about that is that people think that the image is living on chain. In reality, the image will never live on chain because it's very costly to store that on chain. So if we check, for example, the ID zero and we go to the token URI function, here we have the URI that I set up for this token. If we go there and we open a new tab and we go there, we can see here information of the token. Okay, this is already made, but basically once you want to create an NFT project, you will deploy your own server that hosts this. People tend to use the EPFS system, which is a decentralized file system. But here, if we now go to the image URL and we check that, we can see that this is my token that I just minted. Okay. If we now go to Remix again and check the token ID one, and here we have the JSON object. We go here, we check the information, and this is the image for this token, and we can show it here. So this is my second token I just minted. Okay, this is just a quick demo. I don't own an AP yet, NFT token, Halborn does, but this is just a quick demo on how to basically combine the chain information and the off-chain information.
Okay, so in every bit of code that you showed in the ERC-20 token, the NFT, and the smart contract that we deployed, you're referencing to OpenZeppelin, which is a library of used. Can you tell us what that library does, or if there are other libraries you recommend we're looking into?
Yeah, sure. As you mentioned, this is just a library written by like a company which standardized some parts of Ethereum. And if we can even go to the sample token and check the ERC-20 code. And if we go to that URL, you can see that this is just Solidity code. Okay.
Okay.
And basically, you can even copy that in your Remix instance or whatever, and you can just have your own ERC-20 code there. Okay. But okay, as all libraries, instead of doing that, what we do is just import it. Okay, so that's basically the instance as you see on every contract that we have here. If I will recommend other libraries, OpenZeppelin has an amazing set of contracts. Okay, it has not only tokens, but also ways to manage the contract, the ownership of the contract, even provides an airbox system for the contract. And you can even have like crazy governance contracts already implemented for you. Okay. So OpenZeppelin, I will say it's the base of probably like 90% of all the contracts deployed on chain are using at least one contract from OpenZeppelin. Okay. So this is like a must go to.
So when you see in the news or you see online people are finding vulnerabilities in smart contracts, it's pretty much these that you just showed us. Honestly, obviously, they're going to be larger contracts with more code in them that have logical vulnerabilities that causes money or people could steal money from them, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So let me just give you a quick point here. Imagine that in this token, okay, we provide like a min function, which can be called by anyone. Okay. This is like a security risk. So it's very important to be aware of security on smart contracts because by definition, this is going to be public and anyone can interact with it. Even though not everyone will have the source code, they will have the bytecode and they can start decompile it if they want and if they have time, of course.
Yeah.
And it makes sense from a standard point of view to have a security audit on smart contracts because missing just a simple word like only owner, modifier on a function, it can allow anyone to drain everything on the contract.
Okay. I think we may have to come back. I feel like there's a lot to cover with smart contract pen testing and security. We'll come back to that hopefully for another episode. But this is really cool. I don't know if I'll ever do a Naham coin, but knowing that I can come back to this video and kind of like have a reference to look at would be very, very cool. Is there anything you recommend for people that want to get into creating their own smart contracts? Do you have any recommendation or advice for them?
As I said earlier, I would recommend them to go to Remix and play around and type some Solidity code, deploy it locally, because it costs nothing to you, and then you can start deploying it on testnets. And probably, if you want, later on, you can deploy that on mainnet with real money.
Okay, there is one more thing. You mentioned there was a surprise.
Yes. There is a surprise for these YouTube subscribers that you have here. And and this is the Drain Me contract. As you can see, this is a simple contract. Basically, there are two functions, the drain function and the balance function, okay? And this contract has been deployed on a Rinkaby network under this address. Let me show you the address. This is the contract, okay? We will be providing this link under the YouTube description. But this contract has one ether in it, okay? The idea is that the first person who is capable of draining the funds from this contract probably can join us on the next video, or you can do whatever you want here, Ben.
That would be cool. If you do get this one ether, drop us a comment, let us know it was you. Maybe we can reach out to you and do an interview and ask you how you did it.
Yeah, sure. Just one quick point here. There is one rule. We want the username to be on the parameter of the function. Okay, so we know who was the winner.
Perfect. Sounds good. Awesome. Well, thank you so much. Hopefully I get to come back either with you or somebody else, and we can talk about the pen testing part of like finding security vulnerabilities. I feel like a lot of people are fascinated by the whole space with smart contracts, let alone a hacking game. I've seen $1 million bounties by Immunify, for example, being paid out, and I'm very curious to see how those work. Thank you again. I appreciate it, and hopefully we'll get to see who our winner is.
Yeah, a pleasure as always to be here. So hope to see you and talk to you soon.
All right, cool. So do me a favor, leave me a comment. Let me know if we should make Naham coin or Nahomi's a coin. Maybe, I don't know. I don't think I want to do something like that. I'm not built for that, honestly, but who knows? Drop me a comment. Let me know if you want to become a Nahomi and maybe we can do some Naham coins. I'm not sure yet. But the giveaway, we talked about it in the interview a little bit. There is one Ethereum up for grabs. All you have to do is figure out how to exploit and attach a username to that function and grab it and enjoy it on us. That's it. There's going to be a few more episodes coming out. I'm not sure how many just yet, but now that we're done with the basics, we kind of have an understanding of how they work, what the different libraries are, what the different languages are, what a contract looks like. Next episode, we're going to look at some vulnerabilities potentially and how you can audit a contract down the road. Also, if you love this kind of content, please, please, please do me a favor. Leave me a comment, hit that subscribe button, become a Nahomi, like I said earlier in the other episodes, join the team. But also tell me what you want to learn specifically about smart contracts. I really want to make more content on smart contracts. I'm not really familiar with smart contracts myself. It's really outside of my comfort zone. That's why I'm making these videos. I'm hoping I'll learn something, and same with you, you will learn something from it. So drop me a comment, let me know what you want to learn, and I'll be happy to look into it and see if I can find someone who can help us get some of this content done. All right, that's it. We'll be back with another episode in a few weeks. Until then, see ya.